Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 6 of the Dark Matter Knits podcast. It's April 1st, 2014. I'm going to start to say in the date from now on. So I'm recording a little late this week, but, you know, that's how it goes. Went to DFW Fiber Fest this past weekend, so I was a little tired, and I'll tell you more about that in a moment. It was a really great, fun experience, and as I think just everybody had a great time. It's a really good show. So I want to talk about that a little bit later, but first let me just tell you a little bit about what we're going to do today. My podcast is always organized around a theme. So today's theme is Pass It On. And that kind of, as usual, it kind of encompasses a few things. We're going to talk about how, kind of some ideas about teaching other people to knit. One of the things I do for a living, I was thinking about this because I taught classes at DFW Fiber Fest that I've taught a lot, and I also used to be a history professor. So, you know, I've spent a lot of my time thinking about how to teach. And, but a lot of us, you know, even people who are never once paid to teach people how to knit, we all eventually probably teach someone how to knit. And I've talked about this a little bit before with teaching kids, but I think just kind of generally talking about some ideas about how to teach someone to knit for the first time, or kind of some ideas in general about teaching are something I want to talk about today. And the other main thing I want to talk about, in addition to just, you know, some stuff I've been up to this week, is kind of a different take on passing it on. And that is that the group that we have on Ravelry, the Dark Matter Knits group, is already getting pretty active. And I was trying to think about a way that to kind of build on that community in the group. And I thought it would be cool to do a kind of pass it on sort of thing in the group where you could, well, I'll describe it more in a moment, but the basic idea would be to take something that is knitting related or crochet related, something fiber related, that is, or maybe even a book that you've been reading that you really like, but that you're done with, and to pass it on with the idea that that person is then sort of tagged to be it, to pass on something else to someone in the group. And if you're interested in it, it's, you know, kind of a first come, first serve sort of thing. Just let the person know you're interested in it and they'll ship it to you. So I'll kind of get more into the details of that in a moment, but I just thought that would be a fun way to, just sort of engage everybody in the group a little bit and share some of the fun things that we've had in our stash for a while that we don't necessarily need anymore. So, so let's talk first about this, and I'll talk about DFW Fiber Fest a little later on too, which is kind of another way of passing on the love of fiber. First of all, teaching knitting. It's a really interesting, have you ever tried it? It's really interesting to see how people pick it up and to think back to that first moment when you were first knitting. I mean, my mom taught me. My mom has been knitting, you know, pretty much her whole life. And, or at least since sometime in her childhood. And she was a very patient teacher and, you know, very kindly waited for me to ask. She never pushed me to be interested, which is probably why I like it so much. She's always been very good about letting my sister and I just be who we were going to be. And, so my mom taught me, and at the time, I think I learned sometime in the early 80s. And so, you know, a lot of the materials that were available then were those really squeaky aluminum needles. Well, I say squeaky because when I learned to knit, I was using an acrylic, you know, it might have been like an Angora acrylic yarn. Oh, gosh, it basically, the combination of the aluminum needles, whatever fuzzy acrylic blend I was using, and the sweat of my palms, because I had not yet learned how to tamper my perfectionism, created these tight little squeaky stitches that, it was truly horrifying. I mean, at some point, I was making a sweater with this teal colored yarn, because, you know, yeah, we were all about the jewel tones in the 80s. My stitches were so tight that at some point my mom literally had to cut the knitting off the needles because the stitches would not move. They could not slide back and forth. I mean, you could put all your weight into it and they were not going anywhere. So, you know, I think back to those, think back to your own experience of learning how to knit and, you know, what would you do the same? What would you do differently? So one of the things I would do the same, and that I always try to keep this tone in my classroom that my mom set of just relax. I mean, I obviously didn't take that on very well when I was 12, but my mom's attitude that, you know, this is, nothing hangs on this. You know, we're just going to try this. And if it doesn't work the first time, no need to panic. If stitches fall off the needle, we can get them back. In fact, I'll show you how. You know, that whole kind of layer of Valium at the bottom of the class is it's something that I try to emulate when I'm teaching. So I wanted to just talk a little bit about, I mean, everybody's going to have a different approach to teaching people to knit, but I wanted to share with you some of the things that I do when I teach someone. And this applies to whether I'm teaching them in a formal setting where they've actually signed up for a paid beginner knitter class. But I also do these things when, you know, I just happen to sit down next to somebody and they say, oh, I'd really love to learn how to do that. And I have the time and I have the materials and I just want to show them how to knit. I pretty much do the same thing in either case. So one of the things that I try to do, especially if, you know, the resources are available, is to, and this is something that a lot of teachers recommend, is that you make sure that they have materials that will make them enjoy the knitting process. So, and you probably realize this, but bamboo needles are really good material to start with because they're just sticky enough to grip the stitches just a little bit. I mean, it's one of the reasons that more experienced knitters generally tend to shy away from bamboo. It's not always true, but often they sort of move away from bamboo as they get more experienced because it kind of tends to slow down your knitting. But that's what you want when you're first learning, right? You don't, that feeling like you're, all this stuff is just going to go flying off the needles at any moment. It's not a particularly enjoyable feeling. So bamboo, and actually, I really like to start people, it depends, but what I often recommend that they get straight needles, not the really super long ones, not the, I think they're what, 12 inches, 16 inches, but the, you know, maybe like the 9-inch or 10-inch needles. Because one of the things that I found people like to do a lot when they're learning how to knit is use their body as an anchor to, you know, like when they're first trying to manipulate the needles and they've got to wrap the yarn and they've got to hold all the knitting at the same time, actually being able to use your chest or your stomach as another lever can be kind of useful. So straight needles can be good. Although, and this is why I was kind of hesitating before, I often like to teach people to knit in the round, especially as a first project. I mean, maybe for knitting back and forth, you might start with straight needles and just do, you know, start with a swatch where they can just mess it up as much as they want and not worry about stuff falling off. But the first time they do a project, maybe this is a better way to say it, the first time they do a project, I actually like to start them with a hat in the round, and here's why. I don't think that knitting in the round is any more complicated to a beginner knitter than knitting back and forth. In fact, in some ways it takes some of the stress out because you don't have that problem that a lot of beginners have where they accidentally create that extra stitch at the beginning of the row. So there's that. But also, the nice thing about making a hat is that it's a lot less knitting than a scarf. You know, the scarf is kind of the classic beginner project. But if you think about when you've made scarves, how much knitting that is, it's a lot of yardage. You know, it can be, well, depending on the weight, but it can be over 1,000 yards of yarn that you're using in one of these scarves. So a hat, you know, will, okay, maybe it's not 1,000, but, you know, probably be about somewhere between 600 and 800 yards of yarn. I would need to look that up, but it's basically, it's a lot more than a hat. A hat in worsted weight, you can do it for about 200 and 250 yards. So it's a much more manageable project, and you can do a really cute hat that's nothing but knit stitches, right? One of those little roll brim hats. And if you taught them how to purl, they can just do a simple rib at the bottom. So I like to go ahead and get them started knitting it around right away if they want to get started on a project. As far as yarn goes, I really recommend teaching people with wool or at least a nice wool blend, like maybe Barocco Vintage or something like that. Because it's the fiber that creates the nicest looking stitches. It's very forgiving. You probably notice this in your own knitting, that the most even fabric that you get comes from knitting with wool. And I just think people should knit with the best when they start. Maybe not Kvyat, but, you know, knit with something quality and soft. Maybe probably a merino would be a great place to start, a good kind of medium to high twist merino that has a lot of spring to it. It just kind of reinforces that idea that this is actually fun and that you can make something really beautiful and soft and wearable with it. As for the cast on, in my own knitting, I typically, 9 times out of 10, I use the long tail cast on, and probably you do too. I mean, it's probably the most commonly used cast on. I generally don't teach that though when I'm teaching somebody to knit for the first time. If I sense that they just want to get started knitting, I'll just do the cast on for them and tell them, you know, we'll worry about casting on later. But if it's actually, if they want to learn the soup to nuts kind of thing and really get the cast on and then learn how to knit and purl and so on, I teach them the knitted cast on. And that is where you put a slip knot onto the needle, and then you knit into that slip knot, and instead of letting that loop come off the left-hand needle, you transfer the loop that you made on the right-hand needle over to the left. That's not going to be my technique video for today. You can look up knitted cast on. But what I like about the knitted cast on is that it's still flexible and it's easy to knit into like the long tail cast on is. The backward loop cast on, I think, is a terrible cast on to start somebody with, because that's just where you twist a loop of the yarn and put it onto the needle. The problem with that is that if you've ever done a whole cast on that way and then you try to knit that first row, it is incredibly frustrating. And you don't want to set people up for failure. So I don't teach that cast on. The knitted cast on is nice because it's easy to knit into, just like the long tail is. And it makes a nice, you know, fairly flexible but not sloppy cast on, like long tail. And the advantage of that is that if you know how to do the knitted cast on, you've basically got the first 3 of the 4 steps to make a knit stitch. So the knitted cast on is very much like making a knit stitch. And so it's always really nice to be able to say, okay, now that you've got your stitches cast on, let me show you how to knit. And you're going to find this really easy because you've basically just been doing it. So, you know, I always think of that Far Side cartoon where the kid's sitting in the front with a giant swollen head, and he's sitting in a classroom and he says, excuse me, can I please be excused? My brain is full. I mean, you don't want to kind of over stimulate people when they're first learning something. If you try to kind of pack in too much stuff, it can be overwhelming for a lot of people and they might just kind of throw up their hands. So I think just having a few, limiting it to the knitted cast on allows you to teach them how to cast on. So I managed to turn my own video off. My screen goes dark sometimes after a few minutes if it thinks I'm not doing anything. And I was trying to turn it back on and I turned my video off. So now I'm going to move the mouse off of the stop button so I don't do that again. Okay, so basically the idea that, knitted cast-on kind of helps limit the amount of new stuff that you're throwing at somebody to a more manageable amount. The other thing I wanted to mention about teaching a beginner to knit is make sure to teach them to bind off. This is the easiest thing to forget how to do. And I've had so many people tell me who have learned how to knit informally and then take a beginner class, you know, at the yarn store where I teach, that they'll say, this is the one thing that the person forgot to do was teach me how to bind off, because, you know, of course they're not done yet. So it can easily not occur to you that you need to show this to them. So I think at the very least you want to mention to them what the technique is called, because of course they're not going to know that, right? They're just going to know, I need to stop knitting. I need to make it stop. It's done, this thing that I'm making. How do I do that? So just tell them it's called binding off at the least. And you may want to show them how to do it too, because it's simple enough that they can probably remember how to do it, even if you show them before they need it. If you find, now more and more people are actually teaching knitting classes, period. And I wanted to share a couple of suggestions too about, that are perhaps a little less obvious about, how to manage a classroom or, you know, a setting where you've got more than say five people at once. Because what starts to happen then, you know, when you're not just teaching one person or two people, what starts to happen then is that you're having to think about multiple things at once. And this is really the true challenge of being a teacher and being a good one, is to be able to operate at multiple levels at the same time. And what I mean by that is that, number one, different people have different ways of taking on new information. Some people need to see it. Some people need to do it. Some people do better if they can hear it said. Some people, and I'm one of these people, I don't process auditory information very well. You know, my husband's a philosopher, and he'll start talking about something he was talking about in class. And it's not that I don't think, I love what he does. I'm not one of those people, I'm rolling my eyes, not because I think what he talks about is boring or over my head. It's neither of those things. The problem is that he is really good at talking fast and through complicated concepts. And he just motors through this stuff, and I'm kind of like, if I could read it, I'd be fine, right? But when he's talking, I can't take it all in. So people have what is called in the educational lingo, different learning styles. So, you know, one thing to bear in mind is that when you explain a new concept, it's a really good idea to do it more than once, just because people need to, it's new, so they need to see it more than once, but also to do it in more than, as you're doing it more than once, do it in more than one way. Show it, have people do it, describe what you're doing. I like to do little mnemonic devices or songs or kind of visual imagery that helps describe what they should be seeing or doing. Just give people lots of ways of latching on to this new thing and attaching it to something that they already get or know how to do. So, and that means slowing down, you know, really kind of not trying to build too much into any single class, especially if you're talking about beginners. You also need to give, I mean, kind of related to this, you need to give people time to work. And this is always one of the hardest things for me. And maybe this is because I've spent so much time teaching in a academic classroom, is that I always felt like I had to fill the time with information. That, you know, I needed to give them as much information and as much analysis and critical thinking as possible. And so I feel awkward in knitting classes if I'm not talking or giving them more information. And I've come to realize that that's a mistake, that if I'm talking too much, especially when they're trying, when the students are trying to practice something themselves, it's distracting. And, you know, it's just more information on top of the thing they're trying to get right now. So you need to build in time, and pretty substantial time, for people just to practice the technique that you've taught them, to really cement it in their muscle memory. And what, you know, if you're feeling like, well, I should be doing something as this is happening, you can go around the room and check in with people. Invariably, there are going to be a few people who would really like you to help them with something, or go back over something again, or to help fix a mistake that they found, or, you know, whatever. Check to see if they're doing it right. So, I mean, really kind of building in time for that is good. And it's also a good moment, those moments when you're just kind of letting people practice on their own. It's a good moment to, as you're checking in with different people, it gives them an opportunity to let you know if something isn't quite going right for them. Like if you're going too fast, or if something that you said didn't make sense, or if maybe even there was a mistake in something that you said. I had a student in one of the classes I was teaching this weekend who was really upset because everybody else in the class was talking while she was trying to concentrate on something, and she couldn't focus, and she was getting really frustrated. And there were enough people in the class that I didn't notice this at first. You know, usually I'm pretty good at reading people's body language and seeing when they've kind of given up, you know, when they've kind of put their knitting down and they've pushed their chair back, like. And she had done this and I hadn't noticed because there were 20 students in the class. And, but you know, this was one of those times where I was walking around and checking in with people. And to a certain extent, I felt like, I'm sorry, lady, you know, people are going to talk. I can't tell people to be quiet through an entire 3-hour class. But I was able to do something to kind of help her out. So, you know, it's just good to check in on those things. I think the other part of it, of teaching a knitting class in a more formal setting, and this actually ties in with what I want to say about DFW Fiber Fest. A lot of teaching knitting, I'm coming to find, is teaching self-esteem, or at least trying to build up people's self-esteem. It's really interesting to me how many people will express, either in a kind of thinly veiled way, or just they'll just put it flat out there, that they don't have any confidence in themselves, they don't think they can do it, and not even necessarily in a really frustrated way, just like, I'm not very good at things, and I'm pretty sure I'm not going to get this. It's always kind of shocking to me, and so I feel like one of my big jobs as a knitting instructor is just to kind of to use knitting, just, you know, in some ways a pretty low stakes activity. Nobody's going to die, you know. Nothing terrible is going to happen if the knitting gets messed up. So it's a really good opportunity to try to help build up people's sense of self confidence. I wish I had something more thought out to say about this, but you know, women have issues with self confidence, and I think knitting is one of those really, knitting and the fiber arts generally are one of those really interesting places where you can intervene in that problem. So this kind of ties in, like I said, with some of the stuff that I wanted to say about DFW Fiber Fest, which was such a good time. I have rarely had that much fun at a knitting event. DFW stands for Dallas-Fort Worth. It's Dallas and Fort Worth have kind of become a giant metroplex. They're separate cities, but they've kind of blobbed into each other. And the Fiber Fest takes place as of this year in Irving, which is a town that's basically between Dallas and Fort Worth. So let me get to how this ties in first, and then I'll kind of back up and say more about the festival. The speaker at this year's event was Stephanie Pearl McPhee, and I know I'm not alone in this. It's not like I've really loved the Yarn Harlot. Have you heard of her? But every time I've gone to see her speak, and I've gone, this is the third time now that I've been able to hear her actually speak in person. I just fall in love with her all over again. I mean, she's, if you've read her blog, she's a great writer, or if you've read any of her books, she's a brilliant writer. She's one of those people that just kind of sneaks up on you with how smart she is. She's very funny, and you realize eventually as you keep reading that one of the reasons why she's so funny is that she's so smart. And she has brilliant things to say about the culture of knitting and fiber. And they're, you know, it's all told in these, very often very anecdotally, through things that have happened in her life that are sort of humbling and funny. And but so her writing is brilliant. I think she's even better in person. She really, she has the most brilliant comic timing. She's super dry, has that great, she doesn't smile very much. And she, I don't know, I always find that so funny. It just makes me laugh even more when somebody is so dry that they don't even, they're not even smiling through most of their own comic wit. And for some reason, that just heightens the comedy for me. But she really, I mean, seriously, she could have her own show on Comedy Central if anybody over there could recognize that knitting is not just a niche culture. So she was talking about this same issue, about basically about self-esteem amongst knitters. And the kind of the bigger context for this was she was talking about how that in the media, knitters and fiber people in general, crocheters, weavers, but especially knitters, because that's kind of thing that gets the most press attention, that we're talked about like we're idiots, that it's presented as this really niche activity that is odd and cute and not particularly respectable or artful, that we're all just a bunch of simpletons who kind of sit around reviving our grandmother's crafts. And she was basically kind of spent the first half making fun of these depictions of knitting, and then kind of merged over into saying, talking about how it's basically each of our responsibilities to change that, that we need to stop. I don't want to go too much in, I don't want to, you know, sort of do the whole speech, but one of the big points that she made was that when people talk to you about your knitting, to not downplay it. Don't immediately point out the mistakes. Don't say, oh, this, you know, this old thing, this was nothing. It wasn't nothing. It took you, you know, probably at least 10 hours to make that thing. And, you know, think about how many years it took you to be good enough to make that thing. It might seem simple to you now, but that person sitting next to you can't do that. Even that, you know, simple hat that you're working on. So that, you know, she was basically saying we each bear some responsibility for the way that the craft is depicted. And yeah, so it was, I mean, I have not laughed that hard, I think, in years. I was laughing so hard, I was weeping. I mean, tears were streaming down my face. She is a treasure. So that was Friday night. The festival goes on. It's basically Friday, Saturday, and most of Sunday. Things kind of shut down about 4 o'clock on Sunday. And so I got there on Thursday night because I was teaching all day Friday. I taught 2 3-hour classes on Friday. And I have to say, the festival really was just really well organized. You know, from a teacher's point of view, they did all kinds of really nice things that not a lot of other festivals do. For one thing, and I know Stitches does this, but for every full day that you teach, they put you up in a hotel for the night. So I stayed 2 nights. So one of the nights at the hotel was paid for, which was really nice. Especially for somebody who earns a living at this, you know, to have some of the expenses covered is a huge thing. Another nice detail, ahead of time, a few weeks ahead of time, one of the organizers, Liz Gregorian, who's now going to be in charge of the event, contacted me and said, if you get me your handouts for your classes, we'll reproduce them for you. So I also didn't have to print out all my own handouts, which, you know, saved me some money and also saved me some aggravation. I always get aggravated printing my handouts because I try to do them two-sided and invariably I screw them up and end up wasting more paper than I would have if I had just printed them on one side. Nah. I'm getting frustrated and I didn't even do it. Oh, Lord. So that was really nice. And so, yeah, from a teacher's point of view, things were really well organized. And so I got there Thursday night, kind of hung out with some really nice people in the lobby of the hotel that night and that I had not met before. And then I, on Friday, taught all day, 9:30 to 12:30 in the morning, 2 to 5 in the afternoon. Walked around the market just a little bit in the time between. But yeah, mostly taught. And the classes were full or nearly full, which, you know, again, from a teacher's point of view is great. And nice for the students too, because, you know, it means that when classes fill, that means that the big teachers come back. I mean, they had people like Abby Frankamont, Stephanie Pearl McPhee taught a full stable of classes. Myra Wood was there. I mean, there were some really top-notch international teachers there. So yeah, just fabulous all around. The rooms were huge. You know, usually I'm having to kind of wiggle my way around the room trying to get to everybody, and I, you know, had no problem, plenty of space. And then Friday night was Stephanie Pearl McPhee's talk, and got to have dinner with my friend Heidi, who does the Undead Yarn podcast, which was really fun, at a Japanese restaurant. So good. I hadn't had real ramen before. In my mind, right, ramen is like the 20-cent crap that you get at the grocery store when you're in college because you can't afford anything else to eat. That's not ramen. I don't know if you know this. Oh my gosh. I had real ramen at this Japanese restaurant. So good. So good. So yeah, that Friday night, that was delicious. Oh, and Thursday night I had and dinner with Deb Overath and Susan Erickson, I think her last name is. They were there teaching a knit companion class. Very nice people. And then Saturday, I stayed Friday night. And then Saturday was going to, you know, just be my relaxing day. Had breakfast with my friend Jeanette Cross, who's a wonderful designer. And got to meet, ran into Stacey Dawson of the Mustache podcast in the morning and got to talk to her for a little bit. I did her logo and, you know, we've kind of talked online before, but hadn't ever met in person. So it was really nice to get to talk to her a little bit. She's a lovely person. And then just walked around the market and, you know, just kind of enjoyed myself. There was a podcaster meetup at 1 o'clock, which was very fun. It wasn't very big, which was fine. You know, talked about my introversion before. It was nice to just get to hang out with a few people and meet some of the other Texas area podcasters who I've seen but not really ever met before. So, you know, got to meet people from the Mustache podcast, Stacey and Steph. I got to meet Carmen from the Tap Girl podcast. Oh my gosh. I wanted to just be in her pocket for the rest of the day. Just one of those people where I met her and I was like, oh, you're my kind of person. I hadn't listened to her podcast. I think that was why I was so just because I had never listened to her podcast before. I'm sure many of you have. She's been around a while and she's much loved, I'm sure, because she is just completely charming. Really liked her. I got to meet Laura from Jinx Yarns, and she has a podcast as well. So it was just, it was really, really fun. Heidi from Undead Yarn was there too. We kind of went there together. And yeah, just nice to feel like there's some community there, and some people who listen to and watch the podcast were there too. And I had my first fan sightings, like people who would sidle up to me. This only happened twice, but it was still so sweet. People who would kind of sidle up to me, like, "Are you Dark Matter Knits?" I'm like, "Yeah." People call me Elizabeth. So yeah, it was really nice meeting people, and I walked around the market a little bit. I actually tried to stay out of the market as much as I could, because I will just buy things. I'm sure I'm the only one. Let me show you quickly some of the things, because one of the lovely things about going to a festival, right, is that you get to see stuff that you normally wouldn't see, that's not necessarily available at yarn stores. They gave me a bag, which was really nice. As a teacher, I got to, got as a gift, this really nice bag made by Erin Lane. And so it's a, you know, as you can tell, probably tell from the way I'm having to smoosh it, it's one of these really sturdy sort of L.L. Bean type of bags. And, you know, it's fairly roomy inside. It would be big enough for a medium-sized project, probably like a shawl. Well, I don't know. It might be big enough for a sweater. Not a sweater for me, maybe a sweater for you. But yeah, nice little, it's got the logo stitched onto it. So that was really sweet. And then one of my friends had pointed out that there were some really pretty gradient yarns there, including from this company, ooh, so washed out, Little Monkeys, is that right? Yeah, Little Monkeys Stitch and Spin, which I am forgetting where they are based, probably somewhere nearby, but they do these, it's not quite this saturated, it's a little more muted than this, but they do these really beautiful gradients, and of course I had to go for the warm colors. Yeah, it is really not that bright, but it starts with a kind of light yellow here at the center, and then moves to an orange, a red, and then on out to the gray. And I'm thinking what I want to do with this. I have a hat pattern of my own that is knit on the bias, and it basically is knit diagonally. Well, you've seen me, if you've watched a previous episode, that hat that I wear that has the purple stripe across it, I basically want to knit that again with this and see what it looks like in a gradient yarn. So I'm really psyched to knit with that. Oh, I should probably tell you what this is called. It's called a metamorphosis gradient. You'll be able to see this. My camera washes out things too much. The colorway is Catching Fire. And it's about 100 gram skein, 463 yards. So there's quite a bit of yarn in here. And it's a superwash merino nylon blend. Lovely. I really can't feel the nylon in here. It's quite well disguised. Then I picked up Melissa Leitman was one of the teachers this weekend, and she was there, kind of brought a booth with her called Leilani Arts. Here's their card, and I need to look up what their kind of general, you know, philosophy or whatever is, what kind of stuff they carry. But they had this yarn called Studio Donegal. It's an Irish yarn, and looking at it, you're probably thinking this is a pretty scratchy wool, but the kind of miraculous thing about this is it's 100% merino, and it is incredibly soft. When I picked it up, I almost drooled, because it's just, it has the look of this very rustic wool, which I like, but without the scratchy feel. So, you know, I think I might design a men's hat and mittens with this. We'll have to see. But this has, I said it's 100% merino. It's 100 grams, 210 yards. Okay, so I guess this might just be a hat. And it's a 2-ply. So it feels like if you're a spinner, it feels like a worsted spun yarn. I think the guy said that it was. Speaking of spinning, the only other thing I got, it's really trying to be good, were, this was a company, like La Lana Arts, a company I had not come across before. In fact, I pretty much tried to buy all from people that I either had never heard of before or just barely. So this is from Gritty Knits. And it's a Corriedale fiber. I got two braids of it. These are the same fiber, obviously dyed in different colorways. And again, I think I'll, it's 4 ounce braid each. I think I'll spin them separately and then ply them together, as I really like that look. So it's a Corriedale cross, which I think means that the breed is only partly Corriedale. And what was I going to say? It's not very soft. In fact, this was the cheapest of their spinning fiber. But I wanted to try Corriedale. I thought, you know, I'm constantly picking up the really soft wools, but I'd like to try something that's a little more, just want to try different breeds. And I just thought the dye work on this was really lovely. They have very affordable prices. These were each $10. So, and here's their card. I tried to be a good podcaster and pick up cards from each one of them. They are based in Houston, I think, but they have an active online shop. So yeah, didn't spend a whole lot of time in the marketplace, but it was a really good marketplace. So that's why I couldn't spend a lot of time in there. Lots of great Texas and just kind of Western Midwest dyers and notion makers. Great fun. So I should probably keep moving along here. Last thing I want to talk about before we get to the technique video is this idea about this other kind of idea about passing it on, which is to something I just thought would be fun to do in the Ravelry group, and that is to kind of set up a rolling pass it on, pay it forward kind of very casual sort of thing. And the idea is this. I know I've kind of described this a little bit at the beginning, but I'll get it started. I'm going to post this. Better take it out of the bag. I designed a men's sweater in Spud and Chloe's sweater, and I have some left over. It's not a whole lot, but it's about 75 grams, which given that so here's Spud and Chloe's sweater. It's a really nice wool cotton blend. Really like it. And it's worsted weight. It's superwash and organic cotton. A full skein is 100 grams and 160 yards. So this is what, probably about 120 yards of a worsted weight. And it's this really nice kind of mushroomy, oatmeal-y color. So if you've always wanted to try Spud and Chloe sweater, I'm going to post this up as kind of the first thing on offer in the group. And if you'd like it, just, you know, you can be the first person to post after me and say, oh, I'd really like to have this. And I'll just mail it to you. The deal is, though, if you claim something and you get it sent to you, then it's your responsibility to offer up something else and send that along to whoever claims it. So with great power comes great responsibility, in other words. So if you claim something, you need to offer something in return. And I want to emphasize that I really don't want this to become this. I mean, I'm offering you, you know, kind of already balled up yarn. This is not, I'm not giving away one of my precious skeins. I just, you know, this is something, a yarn I really liked. I'm not giving you my junk, but at the same time, you know, I'm kind of done with this. I don't think I'm going to knit with it. I knit this whole entire sweater with it. And I really like the yarn, and I'd like to pass it along to somebody else so they can swatch it up and see if they if they like it enough to do a project with it too. So kind of think about that for, you know, if you want to offer something too. You know, maybe it's a book that you've had for a while that you think is a good book, but you know you're never going to get anything from it. Or, you know, this can be fiber, this can be notions, this can be needles. You know, I have three bamboo circular needles that I'm not going to use anymore. Or, you know, I've got so many stitch markers that I'm just going to give some away. I mean, anything. And it, like I say, it does not need to be high value. In fact, please, let's try to keep it, you know, reasonable. And it doesn't need to just be one thing offered at a time. Like, I'm going to put something up to get things started. But if you've got something you want to offer at the same time, just go for it. Like I say, the only rule is that if you take something, you need to offer something immediately afterwards. I also really don't want to have to manage this. So, you know, let's just all be grown-ups about this. If you get something, offer something. Like, I really don't want to have to kind of micromanage this whole process. So it's just a fun thing. We'll just do it. So that's pretty much the, I forgot. I haven't shown you. Well, I'll show you what I'm working on next time. I mean, I'm pretty much working on the same stuff, and the show's running a little long anyway. So I'm going to stop for now, and I'll record the technique video in just a second. And I'll tag it here on at the end. If you would like to get in touch with me, there are multiple ways you can do that. My website is darkmatterknits.com, and you can always find the podcast episodes there, as well as my blog and patterns and other stuff. There is a Dark Matter Knits group on Ravelry. That's where the pass it on process thread will start. And I am Dark Matter Knits on Twitter, and I am Elizabeth GM on Ravelry. And I will see you in a couple of weeks. Bye.
Hey, everybody. The technique video I'm going to show you today is going to be a fairly short one, but I think it's a really cool tip about how to slip stitches from, like if you were working on a project, let's say that I'm working on this shawl here. Let's say I got to the point where I'm working with some interchangeable needles and the needle is too short. Like, let's say I had picked a 16 inch needle to start with and, needed to move all the stitches over to a longer cable. How would you go about doing that? And this is just a kind of a silly little trick that may seem obvious to you, or it might just be one of those forehead slapping moments where you think, why didn't I think of that? I've certainly mentioned this to people before and they've said, oh, of course, duh, why didn't I think of that? So the idea is this, like, again, let's say I'm working with a cable that's only about this long and I'm realizing, all right, this shawl is getting longer and longer. I'm going to need it to move it over to a longer needle. And you're working with interchangeable needle sets. So this is an Addy Turbo set where you can, you know, take the needle tips on and off of the cable. So here's how I do it. If I wanted to move to a longer cable, I would get my needle set out, get out a longer cable. So here's a nice long cable I can use. I think this is the 40 inch. And then I get out needle tips in a completely different size. And I actually try to get needle tips that look very visibly different in size from the ones I'm using, just so I don't forget to change them out. I want it to be visually very obvious that this is not the right needle. I take the new cable, the one that's not attached to the knitting, and I attach the wrong size needle tip onto one end. Then I go to my knitting. And if you think about this, you know, this is the needle tip I'm going to need to use to knit off of. So I'm not going to remove that needle tip. I'm going to remove the other end. So these are size fives. I'm going to take that tip off and in its place, just to have something here at the end, I'm going to put on the other size nine. So now on my project needle, I didn't put that on right. Just popped right off. So get that back on there. There we go. All right, so on my project needle, I've got I've got the tip that I need to work the project up here where the stitches are. And then I've got the fake tip down at the other end. On the new needle, the one that I want to transfer all the stitches to, I've got the size 5 on the end I'm going to knit with. And then I'll just put, I've got the size 9 on the tip I'm not going to knit with. And now I've got the 5 here. So basically I've got two needles now, two circular needles. I've got the 5s, the size 5 needle tips up here. This is one needle, this is the other. And I'm going to work with these. And as I knit across, it'll just transfer all of the stitches over to this new longer needle. And then when I'm done working across one row, I'll just take this other size 5 tip and put it at the end of my new needle. So basically all you're doing is kind of temporarily using those bigger needle tips as stops at the ends of these needles, working your way across, and then just, you know, switching those size 5 needle tips over to your new needle. And that way you can easily transfer stitches from one needle to the other without having to have two sets of size 5 tips.